It's often exciting to look to the future of UNO, what it might be like in times to come. Sometimes, though, it's important to stop. Stop and take a good look at the past of the university, the people and the happenings that help make the excitement of future history possible. With this in mind, join me for Reflections in Time. It's early in the summer of 1984, and the meeting room in the Epley Library, formerly now the Epley Center, the Chancellor's meeting room, and we're here to visit, as we have been various times if you've seen on some of these other tapes, very informally in what I've come to call Reflections in Time. And really what we do is not reflect on today's time as much as the past, the interesting, exciting past of the University of Omaha and the University of Nebraska at Omaha. And certainly some of the people who've done so much in moving and changing and bringing our university to the position it has in the educational world today relates to the top jobs, the presidents, the chancellors. They've come by various names at this institution as they eventually fit into the hierarchy of the University of Nebraska. And it's our good fortune today to be visiting with Ron Roskens, who was our chancellor here at the University of Nebraska at Omaha for 4 years back in the early 70s. Chancellor, I'm glad you could come. And now, as I think most of you know, and I'll add that too, he's the president of the system, has moved a bit away, and we're going to ask him about different perspectives as he looks at this and the other campuses. But first of all, thanks for coming.
Delighted to be here, Paul. Delighted to be here.
Secondly, I don't think, and there are thousands of people in this area of the world that where these tapes are residing that know you, many of them know you personally, but probably very few know what your roots are like, where you're from, and how you eventually came to be with us here in Nebraska.
Well, I'm just a green country boy, Paul. My roots are very deep in Iowa soil.
Yeah.
I was reared, born and reared, I guess I should say, near Spencer, Iowa, which is about 100 miles in east from Sioux City, mm-hmm. toward the northern border of the state. I spent my entire pre-college days on a farm, which was my parents' farm.
Did you work at it, too?
Oh, yes.
As most
yes.
boys did.
I was fairly tall
Always?
For my age, even back in the younger years, and my dad permitted me, and one remembers these symbolic gestures. That's what they were, really, in many respects,
mm-hmm.
sort of rites of passage. I remember that at age 4, I was permitted to milk a cow.
Ah, the first time.
Now, I don't think I was able to really complete the task, but the point is I was able each day to sit down beside.
You remember getting some milk in
oh,
the pail?
Oh, indeed. And I'm sure that, I don't recall it vividly, but I'm sure that I thought I had completed the task, but I rather think somebody else came along and helped later.
As they say, stripped the cow.
Stripped the cow is exactly right.
Yeah.
And I was able to plow corn behind a single row cultivator
with
a team of horses.
I remember those.
I don't recall what age I was then, but I would guess I was probably 8 or 9. The dad would be there to turn the horses around, and then I'd just follow them down the road.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a big deal. In any event, I then graduated from the City High School, Spencer High School, which was a fairly large school in those days. I think we had about 400 students.
Oh, that's a good size.
And for
school.
Those, for that period of time,
yeah.
it was quite unusual. Of course, many of them were coming from the country.
Before consolidation, right?
This was before the considerable consolidation
yeah.
that has occurred yeah. in the intervening years.
Mm-hmm.
Then I went to the University of Northern Iowa for undergraduate and master's degrees.
Any special reason, if you recall, why you went
well,
to that
the special
particular
reason
school?
Was that that I had intended and frankly thought without question that I would be a farmer
uh-huh.
and therefore would probably go to the what was then Iowa State College.
Mm-hmm.
But a very influential person in my life, whom I refer to as one of my many mentors, was the principal of the high school.
Mm-hmm.
And he strongly urged that I, in fact, he almost directed that I go to Northern Iowa, which was then a predominantly teacher's college. And I did, and that's how I got started in this field.
And you stayed there and started doing some graduate work
too? I taught for 1 year between bachelor's and entry into the master's program.
I looked at your vita. There's a town in Iowa. I forget the
Minburn,
name.
Minburn, Iowa.
Yeah, yeah.
Very small school. I don't recall. Seems to me there was probably 125 or 30 or were that many students.
Mm-hmm.
No more than that. It was a grand experience and one that I would not have traded for anything. But that was the extent of my high school teaching.
Then you had the field for teaching now.
Oh, yes.
And started learning to like it.
Indeed. Then I went to the university. Well, then I went back for the master's degree, after which I went immediately to the University of Iowa and entered the PhD program.
So you decided to go all the way.
Again, I was urged to do so by a number of people whom I respected, I should say, in past tense, and whose judgment at that point in my life I thought was beyond reproach. And so I followed their advice, and I'm not at all unhappy that I did.
Have you ever had thoughts of, wow, wouldn't it be fun to be back on the farm?
Oh, yes. I think I sort of recall, don't I, that you have some farm background.
Oh, yeah.
So that
yes.
You would have some appreciation for what I'm going to say. But I think it is literally impossible to rid oneself of that deep sensitivity for the soil and for nature. For example, I often say the aroma of the soil in the springtime is something
nothing quite like it.
That those of us who've experienced it and had soil in our hands and under our fingernails and so on, we could easily go by. I've said many times, yes, I could be very content back on the farm. Now, I would have to be brought up to date with respect to all of, not only the mechanization, but the aspect of using so many different varieties of seed that in my day it was
simple.
Very simple.
Wheat,
exactly.
Pigs, and cows.
And you one or two varieties of corn, and you just decided which individual you're going to buy from. That was about it.
Yes. Yes.
And then, of course, nowadays we have all of the fertilizers and additives and so on. So I'd have to learn a great deal. But yes, I have a rather deep hankering for the farm.
One of the things I noticed in what you were saying that I found interesting, your dad let you do something when you were four, and then he'd let you go down with a cultivator and turn it around. Now, that's really a lot of work for dad. And to me, it sounded like a parent who took a special interest in helping you learn how to do things.
I think that's very definitely true of my father, my mother as well, in different categories. But I also think that was somewhat characteristic of many of the farmers. See, I was the eldest, and particularly when the eldest was a boy, there was a sense of pride to get that boy out into the farm activity as soon as possible.
Right.
Hence, because I was, I think, fair to say, always somewhat larger than most kids at the same age, I got a little advantage in some of those things. Now, in some respects, I started earlier than I might have liked, look, in retrospect, but not certainly at the time. The rites of passage, another one of them that you will remember very well, is the first time my father said to me, okay, tomorrow you can take the team and the wagon and pitch bundles by yourself. Oh. You don't have to just spike pitch. You can go alone.
Do you think anyone knows but us what spike pitching is?
Probably not, but let's let them wonder. But I think I was age 13.
Yeah.
Now, it was a tough chore.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, to do it alone. But I'll never forget how great I felt driving that wagon up to the threshing machine, and it was my load.
Yeah, that's like
me
in a two-section drag 10 hours a day for a quarter an hour or something. Wow, but I was in charge of it.
That's
exactly
right. Well, those were great days.
Yeah, and that's some of the things that we learned from the farm, just plainly how to work. And to
my own view, Paul, is that there really is no better setting for the inculcation of self-discipline than the farm, because on the farm, we didn't have the choice of saying, we'll milk the cows, we'll do it again day after tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Such as, in the city, even with our own children, we were forever contriving things for them to do. such things as empty the wastebaskets.
Yeah.
Every second day or whatever. Well, if it didn't get done, there was no real right. catastrophic result.
But if you don't
feed
the cows,
it had to be done.
Yeah, yeah.
It had to be done.
Did you come from a big family?
No, I have one brother and one sister. So we were, I suppose, in those days, an average-sized family.
Did your dad, you think, or did he ever tell you, did he anticipate you were going to take over the farm?
I'm sure he did, yes.
Boy?
We talked about that.
What did he say when you decided to...
Never was negative about it. Uh-huh. Neither of my parents attended college. It wasn't so much in vogue in those days, although two of my father's sisters went to college for 2 years and became teachers. So it wasn't something totally foreign. And my mother's brother went to the University of Iowa and became a very well-known attorney. So higher education was not something that was foreign, mm-hmm. but neither of them had had the advantage of that. And so I think they had sort of assumed that, in fact, I know they had, that all of us would get to college, but that certainly one of us would come back and take the farm. Turns out that none of us did.
Isn't that interesting? Wasn't there a time not too many years ago when it really was, especially from the farm, quite a privilege to be able to go to college?
Oh, yes. Oh, indeed.
You know.
In fact, I would say it was probably one generation before me when people from farm or rural backgrounds found it to be really a great privilege, and back behind that further. Mm-hmm. But in my generation, it wasn't so unusual. Not that as many went from a high school graduating class as would be the case today, but nevertheless, it wasn't so unusual. Many, many of my colleagues in senior class went to college. I don't know what percentage. I think we had 110 or 15 in our class, and mm-hmm. my guess is that at least 40 of them went to college.
Oh, that's quite a group. Some years ago. We're talking about what year approximately now?
I graduated from high school in 1950.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I'm now 51.
Yeah. About the Korean time of activity.
Correct.
In terms of national history.
Correct.
Yeah, well, how did that affect you?
Well, it's very interesting. As a matter of fact, it was my first introduction to Omaha.
Oh.
During my junior year in college, I got the notice of warning from Uncle Sam that you may be drafted, so you'd better hurry up. Hence, I took additional hours and finished my 4-year course in a little over 3 years, and indeed was drafted. Now, I left out a segment of information that is important in understanding what I'm about to say. Mm-hmm. When I was a sophomore, and again when I was a junior in high school, I contracted rheumatic fever.
Did you?
I was down 3 months the first time and about a month and a half the second. Fortunately, however, as a result of first-rate medical care and paying attention to what was proposed for me, I have no telltale results whatsoever.
And that is an affliction that for some lasts a lifetime.
Oh, yes.
One way or another.
Sometimes many people have some heart damage as a result of that.
Yeah.
I have absolutely none. Well, in any event, I remember so vividly taking the pre-induction physical in Waterloo, Iowa, which was not far from where I was going to college. Word came back that I'd passed it, and so I was, in fact, graduated in December, something like 10th, I suppose, of December, because it was a quarter system, and then was hailed to Omaha, Nebraska for induction toward the end of December, like 28 or 9 or 30, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
That's my first introduction to this city.
To Fort Omaha, I should imagine.
Fort Omaha is exactly the place.
Yeah.
And I was examined there, and then the physician who was in charge saw on my material sheet that I had had rheumatic fever. So he pulled me out of the line, and he sent me to some specialist. I'm not able to recall, I've thought about this many times, to whom I was sent, nor where it was. But it was apparently a well-known cardiologist
somewhere
in those days.
In the city. Yeah.
Private practitioner. And I recall I had never had such a rigorous physical exam. I guess that wasn't so unusual because who at age 20 or 21 would have anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But I was examined in every way possible. I was handed a folder when he finished, and I remember walking back
to Fort Omaha.
And on the way back, I opened that folder, and of course, the sheet on which he had written contained mostly language that only physicians would understand.
Yeah.
But the last sentence was perfectly clear. It said, and I quote, "No impediments to keep him from serving in the military." So I started whistling "You're in the Army Now" to myself on the way back to the fort. When I got there, the physician in charge, the same one who had sent me to the specialist, said to me, "What have you prepared to do? What have you been up to?" I told him I'd just finished a BA degree and was prepared to become a teacher.
And your emphasis was psychology, was it not? Yeah.
At the graduate level. This was undergraduate,
yeah,
political
yeah.
science at
right.
that point.
I see.
And he sat back and he said, "You know, I think the chances of your contributing something are greater if you go into education than if we take you into the military, because there's such a likelihood of recurrence of rheumatic fever.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get in some climate where you contract rheumatic fever again, you're not going to be of any benefit to anybody." So he rejected me. So I've always said that they were looking for men and not mules.
Interesting, very perceptive.
But that was my introduction to Omaha.
Remember any first impressions of what it was like?
Don't really remember very much about it.
I've
tried since that time to find the name of the physician, but the military does not keep records after a certain period of time. So I've never been able to figure who that was.
At about the time when that good doctor said you'd be better off and better for us as a country if you stick in education instead of messing up your rheumatic fever background. And there we are in about 1940 what?
This would have been 1953. December of 53.
And this was the Korean conflict time,
correct.
Wasn't it?
Correct. Well, I then immediately began searching for a teaching position and discovered that there was one available in Minburn, Iowa, a very small community it's in the sector that would be about 60 miles directly west of Des Moines. Very small community, and I was granted a job there, which was kind of interesting. I was to be a social studies teacher, so I taught geography and history, and what else? Oh, and my minor was speech, so I taught public speaking. But then they also pointed out that the individual whose place I was taking had also been teaching biology. Well, certification is a problem, but in those days, if you had had one or two courses, and I don't remember how many I had had in biology, well, I was qualified. So I don't say that I taught biology. I say that I appeared before the class every day. In addition, I directed I think there were two school plays.
Oh, wow. This is a load.
And then beyond that, it became apparent that someone had to pick up the responsibility for girls' physical education. So I indeed did that, for which I was absolutely unqualified. But again, stretched the circumstances a bit.
I was going to ask you if you drove the bus, too, but that was before buses, wasn't it? About at that time,
That's about the only thing I didn't do. But I had a grand time, and of course it was like being thrown into a pool without knowing all of the rudiments of swimming and having to learn on the spot, and I think that probably benefited me greatly. Following that term, I then taught during the summer at a school for the mentally handicapped in Woodward, Iowa.
Did you find that an interesting
experience? That was an absolutely eye-opening and I think truly inspiring experience for me. A very helpful experience with respect to understanding people with handicaps and so on. Then I was able to get enrolled for a master's degree at Northern Iowa, finished that in a year, and subsequently went to the University of Iowa, where I enrolled in the PhD program.
Whoa, in a year, did you say?
Yes, I finished in a year. Mm-hmm.
You were really rolling.
Well, we took a very heavy load.
Yeah.
And meantime, I should have pointed out also that I was married during that period, that summer.
I'm surprised you had time with all this.
Well, we didn't have much,
too.
I must say. My wife reminds me of this many times. We took, I think, 3 days in Minnesota. As a honeymoon, so to speak, because I had to get back. Our wedding date was August 22. I had to get back because I had been for, I think, 5 or 6 years in a row, or maybe it's 4, relatively speaking, mm-hmm. anyway, a member of the police force at the Iowa State Fair. And I had to get back from my assignment. I had accumulated enough experience and tenure to be assigned to the spot of directing traffic at the main gate.
That sounded like a great job.
Which was a very prestigious position, but a very enjoyable position.
Yeah, yeah.
I recall as a sidelight when President Eisenhower came in at one point.
Isn't
there
it?
I was, the individual who was directing
waving
traffic.
Waving the car in.
Waving him in and so on and so forth. Well, then back to the PhD program, finished there, and then we went to Kent State University.
You didn't tell us where you met. It wasn't on the farm.
We met on
the
campus.
School,
we yeah. met in college. That's right. Uh-huh. We dated for 2 years in college, and then, of course, I was gone for a year, most of a year.
And Lois is an Iowa person, too.
She grew up in Iowa as well around... she was born... actually, she was born in Illinois. Her father and mother were students at Monmouth College in Illinois.
Oh, yeah.
But 9 months after she was born, they moved to Iowa in the southeastern sector. Then her father died, and they spent the rest of their youth, she and her two brothers, mm-hmm. and with her mother, in Eagle Grove, Iowa.
I see.
So then we went to Kent State University, where we remained from 1959 through 1972.
Did you begin there as a member of the faculty?
I began as a member of the faculty, and eventually, and not so long thereafter, I also had an administrative post, which led through a series of administrative posts, culminating in that of executive vice president, which was 1971-72. And then a member of this faculty, whom we had known at Northern Iowa,
yeah.
Professor Marquardt.
Oh, yeah.
We didn't know it at the time,
Marquardt.
But later discovered that he had nominated me for this position of chancellor. And, of course, we went through the processes that are involved, and eventually the president, Mr. Varner, invited us to come here for interviews, and we did, and we liked what we saw, and thank goodness they seemed to like enough of us to feel that it was worth the gamble. So we started on 1 July 1972.
Mm-hmm. I want to go back for just a moment to those days at Kent State, because I think everyone who would watch this tape in the last 20, 15, 10 years, when they hear of Kent State, think of almost one thing if they're not acquainted with that university. And you were there, as I understand, during that period, the Kent State riots.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, because of the type of position you held at the time, you were probably heavily involved in some of the relationships that were affected because of all that.
Yes.
Would you care to comment a little bit on that?
Well, it was a very difficult circumstance, and one that can scarcely be described in terms that would be meaningful, even if one took several hours to do it. Mm. Because the milieu out of which all of that turmoil arose was so multifaceted in terms of what we might call causes.
This was the restless 60s, right?
That's right, that's right. The Students for Democratic Society, SDS, as you may recall the term,
yes, yes.
were very active on the Kent State campus. In fact, in their national literature, they targeted Kent State as an institution that, quote, should be brought to its knees, unquote. I think they did so because it was an institution made up of largely first-generation students, and it was assumed by SDS that these students wouldn't be so sophisticated and thus would be more vulnerable to the tactics that SDS employed. In any event, we had almost daily for a year and a half demonstrations on the campus, marches, riots, some minor, some fairly major.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, on that fateful day, the 4th of May in 1970, the National Guard having been called in, all of these circumstances are fairly well known, there was the confrontation, and eventually shots rang out, and four students unfortunately died.
Yeah.
That became the single most turning point in that era, I think, without much question.
Yeah.
And I think we all felt that we learned a great deal from it, which is another story. But nevertheless, that was an episode in our lives that cannot be forgotten.
No.
It was a very telling proposition. It is not one on which I personally wish to dwell, and I don't mean that with respect to the moment that, of our conversation, but just in general.
Mm-hmm.
I think I and others who experienced it learned a great deal from it, and what I'm getting at is that, among other things, we learned that it was essential that we communicate more effectively with students, and the we was both faculty and administrators.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you can recall, and most everyone can, the marked differences in structures of institutions that occurred as a result, in part, of that experience.
Oh, my. For those who are watching and living through any portion of the 60s, whether they were touched as much as you and your colleagues were, they can feel and remember what a period of boiling unrest.
Yes.
In so many ways that was. It even touched briefly and modestly our own campus here at the University of Omaha at that time, yes. Well, let's move back then to you. One thing I wanted to ask you, though, before we moved on, there was a turning point, it sounds like, in your life. You came as a member of the faculty to Kent State University, and gradually or almost immediately, you started to be an administrator. Was this something that you pointed toward? Did it just happen? Did you have it in the back of your mind? How did that come
into being? I don't know that I ever had a specific design on what I wanted to do in my life. I do know that I was greatly influenced, as I've thought about this in retrospect. I was greatly influenced, for example, by the 4-H group with which I was associated as a youngster,
mm-hmm.
and by the Future Farmers of America. I'm talking about influence in the context of leadership,
yeah.
and how one functions in a leadership role and so forth. And then I subsequently was elected president of the student body in high school, which was so foreign, there isn't time here to describe it, but was so foreign to something for a farm kid in a city school.
But people look to you, it seems, for leadership.
Well, it so happens that, again, that, the other aspect of peculiarity there was that I wouldn't have dreamt of running for the presidency of the student body. I'd never been a member of the student council, nothing of the sort. But again, that high school principal, to whom I referred earlier, said, you should be a candidate.
He had a heavy influence in you.
Very strong influence.
Yeah, yeah.
And I said, well, what do I need to do? And he pointed out that, well, the only thing you really need to do, we're going to start a new procedure this year. Whomever wishes to be a candidate will have to give a speech before the student body. Mm-hmm. That was my introduction to politics. And I was elected there. Then when I went to college, some people sort of rallied around at the point at which I think I was a sophomore and said, we must elect you president of the student body, and I was elected there. So I have experienced the leadership role to some extent.
Did in each of these cases, as it began, as you describe it, did you enjoy it?
Oh, yes. Indeed, I did.
Not that you pointed toward it, but when you
I enjoyed it. For example, in college, that position gave me a considerable amount of opportunity to be in the presence of the president of the college or the university,
mm-hmm.
whom I greatly admired, and who also is a kind of role model of mine. So I have a suspicion that subconsciously I was getting increasingly sensitized to roles like that which I'm now performing.
Uh-huh.
But I have never had, nor will I ever have, a master plan for my life. And I say that with full knowledge that there are those people who've been very successful and who remain so, who say, my life is going to be in blocks of 5 or 6 or 7 years, and I will move from this kind of thing to that kind. And they've done it.
Yeah.
Mine is not that way. We were at Kent State for 13 years. We've now been in Nebraska almost 12.
Interesting observation. I was wondering the qualities of leadership and how they fall on one's shoulders and why they fall. That's interesting. It didn't. It wasn't something you worked on. It just came to you, and as a result, there you are. We can often look at our lives and wonder, how did this all happen?
That's correct.
Key people that you mentioned.
It's the key people. Yeah. It's the mentors, in my view.
Yeah.
Nice. I think we had, at least that was my judgment, a massive inferiority complex for a number of reasons. It was evidenced, for example, in the frequent references that people made to me, often in the hallway, in my early days on the campus. Faculty members would engage in a brief conversation, and as we got acquainted, almost invariably, such individuals would advise me the one thing that I needed to know, and that was that the Lincoln faculty was getting all of the funding and support, and we were just a stepchild, and that I should get in and start fighting for UNO. And I've often said that that I had a great deal of assistance from above. I think, as a friend of mine used to say, God was with me, because I took the position immediately, which I think had I not done it immediately, I would not have been able to follow through on, that we would not engage in a comparison with University of Nebraska Lincoln. First of all, it was in my mind unjustifiable, because it's an entirely wrong word. It's a quite different mission and role.
Yes.
And secondly, it seemed to me that we ought to make or break our future on our own. So we charted what I thought and still think was a fairly rigorous and fast-paced path, which on the one hand was designed to kind of rehabilitate the feelings and rejuvenate and revitalize the competency that we had in the faculty here,
yes,
while at the same time communicating to the general community, the greater Omaha environs and so on, that this was not, by any stretch of the imagination, some insignificant little institution that was attached to the University of Nebraska. So we initiated a number of programs simultaneously. I don't know that I could even recite them in order, but I recall that we decided we ought to invite the major corporations to bring their leadership, which meant middle management and above, to a breakfast on the campus.
We prepared to bring people from the community.
Correct. We prepared in those days a two-screen presentation.
Yeah.
Three screens were not so well known yet, for about 8 or 10 minutes. The companies paid for their own breakfast. I recall each company would bring maybe 100, 150. Then we started the ABC series, which was designed to attract, for A, the academic people, for B, the business, and for C, the general community people.
Sort of a natural outgrowth of the first series.
And exactly. Mm-hmm. And the breakfasts were initiated with James Michener, and we thought we thought if we had 250 people, that would have been a smash. Well, we had to turn off the ticket sales at 600, and so far as I know, every single one since that time has drawn more than 600 people.
Yeah.
And often when I'm back in the community at this or that or another function, someone will say to me, do you know what the greatest thing that UNO is doing outside the campus?
Mm-hmm.
What? The ABC series.
Yeah.
Well, it has had tremendous impact, and I think very desirable. Meanwhile, we were growing as an institution. In stature, yes, but in numbers of students, which meant added faculty, new faces, new administrative people. And we were on a roll, it seems to me, for several months, even a few years there. And I think for that matter, we're still on it in many respects. And we began to discover that the old phrase, West Dodge High, was used only to generate a little humor. That is to say, it was not characteristic, and for that matter, some people resented it because it just didn't fit. And the quality of this institution grew by leaps and bounds. I recall the visitor of the North Central Association team.
Yes.
In about 1975
or
six, something like that. They were glowing, uniformly glowing, with respect to the quality of the faculty and the programs at this institution. Well, I think at that point it could fairly be said that UNO was standing tall on its own feet. Not that it couldn't have or shouldn't have previously, but the community had begun to recognize the validity of this part of the University of Nebraska. Students were coming in greater numbers, which was testimony to the quality in part.
Yes, yes.
Faculty were happier. They're all, you know, that's ups and downs,
ups and
depending
downs
upon what circumstances of the moment are. But in any event, we also added new facilities during that period of time. New College of Business Administration,
yes,
building, the Performing Arts Center was just getting, was near completion when I came. And we got the new HPER building on the drawing boards.
Yes. That was a long, hard fight.
That was, but it was worth it.
Yes.
So a lot of these things began to come together, and the institution solidified, I think, to the point at which most people, so far as I can discern, even today, feel that if I'm associated with the University of Nebraska at Omaha, I'm associated with a first-quality institution.
You know, that's a hard thing to come by. It's such a ambiguous thing. Quality in education is a term that you can go on about forever. And still, it's hard to take a hold of. It's sort of like grabbing at feathers. You mentioned one of the things that I thought of, too, in your description there. Right away, you got into the business community, helped bring them together, got them involved. We were encouraged, as I recall, as a faculty and staff, to go out and speak and get involved with the community.
Precisely.
From our end, too, help them in problems and
Precisely.
Projects.
Precisely. And you did it as a faculty.
I think of the urban studies area and all the various studies that we've done in the business college and going out even now after the merger in many years past and doing things. So that's the thing really you're talking about and getting out amongst them, really.
Exactly right. And it was great to have people like yourself who got out there and who indeed represented us and made it clear to the people of the general community that this was not some insignificant college, but rather was worthy of its name.
You know, as you mentioned that, I think of an organization we used to have here called Town and Gown Orchestra, which would involve musicians from our campus and from the community. It was a nice together thing. In your travels around the world in educational circles, which you have done so much of in years past now as an administrator, do you find other campuses having some of the same problems that we had?
Oh, yes.
Of merger and relationship,
yes,
between campus,
yes,
and that sort of thing? It's not just us.
You would find it in Missouri, where there's a system like ours. You would find it in Wisconsin, especially because they have so many more campuses. You'd find it in Illinois. You find, well, in fact, most states now have university systems.
Mm-hmm.
And there are those what I call artificial barriers, because they are only in people's minds. There are no physical barriers that cause problems between Lincoln and Omaha, or UNO and UNL, mm-hmm, or the medical center and UNL, or whatever. It's all psychic. You know, we have sensitivities about this or that,
yeah,
which are kind of senseless when,
yeah,
you think about it.
It reminds me of the state you came from, you and your good wife, Lois, and all the consolidation, the pain and pull of that, of where are we going to put the school and who is best off when we take the school out of the little town where you were and
That's
place it
right.
somewhere else. And, you know, the ultimate goal is the same for everyone, but it's terrible to get it on.
It just doesn't make any sense to me at all, and I will be very blunt about this. For people from Omaha or Lincoln, for the moment not talking about the university,
no,
to speak derisively of each other. And there is some of that.
Yes.
Or for people in one or the other of those two major cities to speak negatively about people in greater Nebraska, or conversely, people from greater Nebraska who say, oh, I wouldn't give you a nickel for an Omaha.
Mm-hmm.
Statements of that sort.
Mm-hmm.
Ludicrous. We are all members of this great state of Nebraska. We ought to be proud of what each other does. And I'm happy to say I think the university contributes somewhat,
mm-hmm,
to lessening those tensions, but they're ridiculous tensions.
You know, one thing I wanted to ask you, you came following the merger as such when it took place, but as you've worked with this campus, the entire university system now for a number of years, if you had your druthers, we often improve on hindsight, and the kind of merger activity which we went through, which was hurried back in the 60s, would there be things that you would like to have done differently if you had been here and involved at that time?
I really wasn't here early enough to have seen all of the birth pains. Some of them I've heard about. Mm-hmm. At the point at which I arrived, which was 1972, the merger was 4 or 5 years behind.
Yes, yes.
But I have a feeling that there were some things that were perhaps not as clearly defined as they might have been. Mm-hmm. But again, that's easily said in hindsight, because after all, accomplishing what was in fact achieved through the legislature and so on is really quite remarkable. As you think about it.
Yes. The speed with which it really was affected.
That's right. So I'm sure that there are details that could have been more carefully ironed out, but I don't have anything in mind that I think is major.
But the trite phrase comes to mind, there's such pain in progress, and we certainly had a lot of that in the growing pains of change and in those early comments that you had from faculty in the hall,
correct,
drawing comparisons between the various campuses and ours and that sort of thing. I think you've emphasized this in earlier on in the tape in both your own life and your work in education, how important people are. And as just names come to mind, as you visit and think about it now, as you came to our university and lived and were a part of us for those years, who are some of the people and the programs that stand out?
Well, let me say that I'm very much appreciative of the question, and I'm sure that I could be responsive to it, but I'm very hesitant to do that.
You want to leave
because
someone out.
It's very easy in a situation like that to omit someone or some programs. So I think I'm going to beg off that question with a slight exception. I do think it imperative that I comment upon those persons with whom I was most closely associated, mm-hmm, in the administrative apparatus, which is not to suggest that I regard administration to have been the most important element, but only because I do not wish to begin naming some of the many, many good friends and very competent faculty members who are here,
yes,
lest I should leave out several.
Understandable.
But I remember very well the contributions, and with great affection and admiration, the contributions of Herb Garfinkel, mm-hmm, who was vice chancellor for and provost, of Dr. Ron Beer, who was Vice Chancellor for Student Services and Educational and Student Services, of Harold Kiefober,
yes,
who was the first Vice Chancellor, he was business manager before he became Vice Chancellor, and then subsequently Gary Carrico, and the individual who was here when I arrived as Dean of Academic Affairs,
Gaines?
Dean William Gaines.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Those people I would feel remiss had I not mentioned their presence. And of course I should also mention Charlie Hine, who was a member of that team as well.
Yeah, there were a number of people, some whom you brought, but most of the people you mentioned were in fact here, and working when you came to the university.
Correct.
You touched on it a little bit, but yes, during your time here there was really growth and change. And physically we really changed. Again, let's reemphasize the building activity that took place during your time, whether it started right then or was finished after you went to your
Performing
next
Arts Center,
yeah,
College of Business Administration, the new library,
mm-hmm, which is a monstrous,
which is a beautiful facility,
yeah,
and there is another that I'm.
How about Kaiser Hall?
Kaiser Hall was already here.
Yeah, that's right. The education building was.
Yes,
that's right.
Maybe we've named
it. We mentioned, didn't we? We skipped.
Oh, the HPER building.
The
HPER building. That's the one.
Yes,
that's it exactly. I knew there was another one.
Yeah.
And we also got the turf for the football field.
Enlargement of stadium. And all that. Now, this doesn't relate necessarily to this campus. It can relate to the entire university. But I know that you personally have a great interest in sports. Some faculty and administrative people and presidents don't. And you mentioned earlier some of the things that make up for a good student education. I'm just interested in your opinion, and we've got a couple of minutes left on this tape, a quick opinion on the role of sports in education.
I think sports play a significant role in college or university experiences for students, either as participants directly or as witnesses, fans, if you like. I say that without the time to rationalize it, but simply put this way. It is a part of, by tradition, a college or university.
Yes.
And therefore, if it's done well, meaning if sports do not become the tail that wags the dog, I think they have a very significant place and a very important role in the lives and welfare of students and faculty. Not every one of them, but many.
I wish you now, if you would, we'll sort of draw it together. There came a time when you left us. Didn't go very far, but you left us and took a different role in relation to the university. What are some of your feelings of pride as you look back on your years here, of things that happened that you feel were good for us, and also maybe some problems that still need attention and are being attended to?
Well, I guess my own sense is that the greatest satisfaction that one can have is to see an institution with which he is associated, in this case myself, flourish, and the people involves expressing a new sense of vigor and vitality and feeling that they indeed deserve to be recognized as a first-rate faculty member and collectively as faculty throughout the institution. And just to see those people then begin to advance new thrusts, new programs, new approaches, including the technology that was developing in a variety of fields.
Mm-hmm.
That one can have no greater satisfaction than that. It returns again to the thesis which we've mentioned before, and that is an institution like this, or any for that matter, grows and prospers to the extent that it is made up of people who are motivated to grow and prosper. And we had that here.
Yes.
We had it in great numbers. And so I look upon our experience here as one of enormous satisfaction, not in the personal egotistical sense so much, although I wouldn't deny that I have a fair amount of ego buried on this campus because I was here.
Mm-hmm.
But that is not how that is not the perspective from which I look at what happened here. Rather, it was just a sort of coming together of many people. And I'd have to say, without exaggerating, that you were one of them.
Thank you.
And the vitality of which I spoke has persisted. There have been some bumps in the road, but it's still a road.
One of the things you mentioned as you gained your first perceptions of the university was the lack of relationship, it appeared, between the total campus and the community. Did you feel comfortable that that was in better multiple hands by the time you left?
Oh, the change there was probably even more dramatic than that of which I spoke of the faculty.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was almost as though there were a wall between the city and the university. I will never forget asking people whom they knew, as we became acquainted with in the general community, whom they knew at the university, and finding in ever so many cases they couldn't think of a single name.
Mm-hmm.
Occasionally the dean of continuing education, Bill
Gaines.
No.
Oh, Bill Utley.
Utley.
Bill Utley, yeah.
And this is not in any way to speak negatively about Bill Utley. That is, that was to his credit. Nor so much necessarily of the others. But the fact was that people just didn't have the outward sense of involvement. Well, a few years later, there are names that people could whip off like that.
Yes.
Many, not
yes.
just a few.
Yes.
And you know today how involved you and others in this university are in the community. I don't care what it is that you mention, whether it's an artistic group or a civic unit or a service club or whatever, massive numbers of UNO people are involved.
No, it's become very, very common. And
it would be the exception not to be involved rather than the rule.
Yeah. Now, an interesting thing, word you used, and from occasionally you've used it in our taping as we've been together today, is perception. I think a psychologist often uses that. And you had certain perceptions of the university as you came to us, you and your family, in the early 70s. You had some differing ones when you left. You felt comfortable about lots of things, but I don't want to use the word suddenly because it didn't necessarily happen that way. And it's a little muddy in the history in my mind. I want you to go through it step by step. You were our chancellor and had been, and perhaps anticipated staying here for certainly a number of years. Well, that wasn't to be because the call came to, well, if you'd pick it up there, because
yes.
I think there's where we're a little muddy. And
all right, let me
really
tell you
happened.
How that happened. It was a situation in which my predecessor, Mr. Varner, announced rather suddenly in June that he was going to retire from the presidency December 31, 1976.
Mm-hmm.
Search committee was immediately appointed, of which the three chancellors were a member. I, being a chancellor, was delighted that we would have an opportunity to participate in the selection of the individuals whom finally the regents would narrow and from among and choose one.
Mm-hmm.
We provided a list in October, late October, of I think six or seven names, I've forgotten exactly how many. And for one reason or another, all of those names evaporated by the December meeting, which was the 11th day of December, 1976. And Mr. Varner had made it patently clear that he would not stay on one additional day.
Mm-hmm.
So it became obvious that an acting president was essential. I remember the day very distinctly because it happens to have been my birthday. The regents went into executive session. I don't remember how long, maybe an hour or whatever. They came out. Chairman called them back to order, and Regent Hansen made a motion that I be appointed acting president effective 1 January. And therefore, on the 1st or 2nd or 3rd of January, I began commuting to Lincoln from Omaha every day.
What was your first reaction to this rather sizable change
in your life? I must say, it's a difficult thing to do.
Yeah.
Because, first of all, the daily, early morning, that part doesn't bother me so much because I'm accustomed to that.
You're an early
But then
man.
Late at night, or late in the evening sort of thing, and many times events that kept me from getting back until quite late, and then right around in the morning back again. It's a tough chore.
Yes.
But I enjoyed, again, the people with whom I was more closely associated than in the system office. And then another search was instituted. I don't know a great deal about that because mm-hmm. I wasn't involved. But in any event, at the April board meeting, the regents concluded that they would like for me to take the post, which I did. And so I am now in my 8th year as president of the University of Nebraska.
You know, I think it's a tribute to you, what you're saying there very mildly and modestly, that going back to some of your comments about our feelings, ours, a collective faculty here, about relationships and comparisons with the UNL campus, how someone from within could finally be chosen to lead all.
That was probably one of the major problems in the minds of some, if not many people at the time. I was not told about it at the time, but later, in fact, quite a number of people have said to me, I didn't think it was a very good idea mm-hmm. to have someone from within, and especially from UNO.
Yeah, yeah.
But I must say that we've tried very hard not to let that be a factor in our approach to administering the university. I don't think of UNO as a part of the university that should be favored, nor, conversely, should I bend over backwards not to favor it. I've tried to the extent that I'm capable of being fair.
Mm-hmm.
And I say that because I feel rather strongly that that's important in an institutional operation like this.
You've been at this for 8 years now in this role as president of the entire university. Has your perspective and your feeling about education generally changed because of this? You look at it from, a different chair.
Yes, to some extent one could hardly avoid it because, for example, my direct association with students and faculty is much less now than it was before.
You miss that?
So I'm much more, I do indeed,
mm-hmm.
and I am much more involved in policy determination and policy reflection, not alone for our own system, though that is an important part of my assignment, but as well I'm increasingly involved in various organizations at the national and regional level. At the moment, I'm chairing the North Central Association, and I will be the chairman of the American Council on Education come October, its board of directors, I should say. Mm-hmm. Well, those kinds of involvements mean consideration on a wider base of educational policy for today and tomorrow in our country and in Nebraska. And so that has changed my perspective somewhat, yes.
We've probably got around 2 minutes left on our tape number four here in this story to be continued. But as this perspective has changed, and your involvement at the national and international level in educational matters, what about the future? Is education going somewhere where it isn't now? Are things going to remain about the same? What do you think?
Oh, I think that the importance of advanced education will continue to be a prominent feature of our country and our state. More and more people talk about it, and appropriately, as a as an economic investment that is of key consequence if the country is to advance, and I happen to believe that.
Yes.
So I suppose the delivery systems will be modified somewhat as technology changes and is modified, but I don't think that the teacher is going to be replaced. Some people will suggest that we'll be teaching by machine and so forth. I don't think so at all.
Just like radio didn't do away with the telephone, or television didn't do away with radio.
Not at all. The other feature I'd like to mention very quickly that we won't have time to amplify, but just to suggest its prominence, overriding significance in my mind, is that of an international focus. And we have worked very diligently to open the eyes of our associates, many of whom didn't need it, but more importantly, the people of the greater state of Nebraska, to the importance of exchange of faculty members and points of view and understanding other cultures around the world.
I want to thank you sincerely for taking time from a busy schedule to visit with us on Reflections, and be assured you'll be asked to come back and to continue this story as your work with the university continues.
You've been
watching the fourth tape in our series of Reflections in Time with Dr. Ronald Roskens, the president of our university, who was our chancellor here at UNO for 4 years, beginning in 1972. We thank him. And we want you to know, and I want to emphasize, that this is tape four, but it's to be continued as the life and times of our university and Dr. Roskens continues together.